Hello, ladies and gentlemen, nice to see you back. And we are with Ashwin Balaji and we are discussing on eclipses. If you have not watched the part one, then please go and watch. And this is the part two, where we will discuss about Greece and some examples and some insights on how the eclipses played a role in their economy and in their stature. So Ashwin, please enlighten us.
Yeah, thanks. So we saw a holistic or a very minor bird's eye view of how eclipse might have actually impacted Greece. We discussed a fair bit of it in the previous video, like how the eclipse on the ascendant and how Mars here had a little bit of impact, not a little bit but greater impacts, and there are eclipse cycles which actually take us far behind, even up to 2000 years. So we'll get back to the economy part in future videos, but still now I want to specifically discuss, which I said in the last video, like the eclipse that happened in 2018, July 12th, 27th and 11th. So 12th of July was a solar eclipse and 27th of July was lunar eclipse, and August 11th was solar eclipse. So to give a very precise view of it, we have the solar return chart of Greece here. So we see the solar return chart here. Sun is almost exactly at the same degrees as it is natally. So so from the 12th house, from the national horoscope, this is the national horoscope, and from the 12th house of the national horoscope, where Mars is already placed in the 12th house of the eclipse where it happened in Capricorn. We all know that eclipse happened in Capricorn. Okay, so this is the chart, rough chart during the eclipse, and I've set it up for 23rd July, but there was a solar eclipse on 12th July. But I'm not analyzing the actual impact of a particular eclipse, but I'm analyzing the entire eclipse season or the cycle, which started from July 12th to August 11th, because it the planets were placed in the same sign precisely, except for the moon. Okay, so we have Mars here. It is a looking at the national horoscope, Mars is already placed in Capricorn, and this is the eclipse chart, and we have Mars here going retrograde. So it is kind of a Mars return, and we have the node placed here as well in Capricorn. So the eclipse is happening in the sign of Capricorn and Cancer, where Sun is placed with Rahu and Moon is placed with Ketu. So what happened exactly, the incident that happened exactly, is Greek was fighting fire where it was spreading in a particular place, and finally there was information about 80 to 90 people had died due to the fire, and it is probably one of the worst fires, fire incidents or fire related catastrophe in a long period of time. And so in the previous video we already said and discussed that it might be a very crucial period, especially for kings. I told the Babylonians and Chinese used to do substitutes for the king, but in order to prevent the actual catastrophe for the king itself. So here Sun is the government, and it is almost implied that the government needs to take some kind of measure in order to rectify something bad that has happened. Okay, and eclipse signifies that. So it happens due to the eclipse. So Sun, how does Sun play a major role here? Sun is already a part of eclipse, and without Sun there is no eclipse. So Sun is already a part of eclipse, and whenever eclipse happens, there is some kind of thing, something that happens nationally. If you follow closely, there might be a small incident which might be giving trouble to government in terms of rectifications and stuff. So here what did Greece face is fire. Whether it is a natural fire or it is negligence or it is a it kind of slipped from our eyes, I think we'll see it later on, but we first analyze how the eclipse is causing all this. So Capricorn is an earth sign, and we have Mars, a fire planet, which is going retrograde here. This is July 23rd, and Mars had just gone retrograde, I think, before a month at around June 26th, if I'm not wrong, but I don't remember the exact date. But Mars went retrograde by about at about 1 month before this, 1 month or 20 days before this. So a retrograde planet is considered to have a lot of focus and strength in a particular place where it is placed, because of the fact that a retrograde planet is assigned Cheshta Bala. Cheshta Bala is nothing but motion strength. And we all know, like, whenever we are doing a work in a normal pace, we might do it with some kind of quality. But whenever we are doing at a slower pace, we do it with much more better quality and precision. So, which precisely means that we give so much of concentration and focus towards what we are doing because we are slowly doing it. And Mars, which is usually a faster moving planet, is actually retrograde, and it is moving very slowly than its usual speed. And Mars has a lot of concentration, and Mars is a fire planet, and Mars is placed in an earth sign. So it is almost imperative to understand that some part connecting the land is going to be affected due to fire or fire related incidents. Okay. And we also have Ketu to kind of amplify all these effects. And we see that Ketu is at 12 degrees and Mars is at 11 degrees, 11.02. So it's almost less than 1 degree. It is almost a perfect conjunction that Mars is getting into with Ketu. And the other thing is dispositor of Mars and Ketu, Saturn, is placed in a fire sign. So this is even more acting as a catalyst in this case, in terms of activating Mars to a further detrimental effect. And Mars is actually aspected by Sun. It is a mutual aspect or opposition with Sun, which is a giant fireball. So we have a lot of fire connections here. And we have Mercury, which is an airy planet, which is actually aspecting Mars and Ketu here. And we all know that fire spreads fast because of air. So it is kind of, we have almost established why fire related incident has occurred. And Rahu here signifies an even better thing, which we will come back later on, and its relationship to Moon. So how does it relate to the national chart? Mars is placed here, and it is Mars return, and Ketu is conjunct in the 12th house of national horoscope of Greece, and 12th house means hospitalization and troubles. So it is very easy to understand that so many people would have been hospitalized due to fire related incidents. And Moon in the natal chart is placed in Leo, and Moon signifies people, and the natal Moon is actually trining Saturn. So I always understand that the trine aspects are not always easy. Trine aspects are easy in terms of making things happen, and here the trine aspect has probably facilitated in terms of a catastrophe, in terms of helping a catastrophe happen in Greece, and which is related to fire. So, as it is, we have Sun, Mercury and Rahu on the ascendant itself. So, and the trine aspect between natal Moon and the fire chart, the eclipse chart, not the eclipse chart, but the fire chart, we have Saturn retrograde in a fire sign itself. So there is a lot of significance in terms of how fire is playing a major role here. And this is the Greek solar return chart. And in the solar return chart, again, we see that Mars is forming a sextile, almost a perfect sextile with Ketu here. Sextile aspect is almost like a train, which kind of which kind of has a free-flowing effect, like what trine signifies, but a sextile is a lesser dosage of a trine. So from here, if we see the fire chart and the solar return chart, we see that Mars is having a sextile relationship with the fire chart, the eclipse chart. So solar return Mars is having a sextile relationship with the actual event chart where Mars is placed. So there is a lot of significance that signifies fire. So, and the other thing is, I wanted to talk about Moon here in the fire chart. Moon is debilitated in the sign of Scorpio. And I already said that Moon signifies people in mundane astrology. And Moon's debilitation is probably one of the major reasons why so many people have passed away in that unfortunate incident that was caused by fire. And we also know that Rahu is almost trining Moon. And how does Mercury play a very important role here? Again, Mercury rules the Jayashtha Nakshatra and Moon is placed in Jayashtha Nakshatra. And here we have like Mercury is the star lord of Moon. So again, we are establishing the fact that fire has spread due to air. So without air, fire doesn't spread. Basically, fire needs oxygen, and one of the major components of air is oxygen. So that's where Moon, Mercury and Rahu, which is a smoky planet, that kind of acted as a pushing catalyst behind helping Sun and its natural opposition with Mars and Ketu, obviously is a kind of major detrimental factor in terms of what Greece faced. So yeah, this is precisely what I had. So how does Mars and Mars in this, and this is a return of Mars. So we know that there is something terrible that is going to happen with eclipse happening there and Mars being eclipsed. So the other major factor that we see here is that in the national horoscope is that most of the planets fall in between the nodal axis, with only Mars and Venus in like outside the nodal axis. So this is also not it's not outside anyway. The planets are falling in between the nodal axis, but we always take from a clockwise point of view so that we see that all the planets are placed in the nodal axis except for Mars and Venus. So Greece is having a very like it is an abstract or an intangible relationship that it has with eclipses, and it is reflecting in the fire chart as well, where there is a clear Kalasarpa dosha, where all the planets are actually placed in between Rahu and Ketu in a clockwise direction, because we count signs from 1, 2, 3 like that in a South Indian chart. So Rahu in Cancer and Ketu in Capricorn, all these planets are placed in between the nodal axis or in the nodal axis, and all these planets have kind of faced not a suppressing effect, but still the planets that are close to the nodal axis might never have had that kind of visibility, or we as humans would never have had that kind of visibility or clarity in terms of the significations of that particular planet in terms of the natal chart and also the transit chart. So here again, later I read a statement in Wikipedia stating that the fire actually happened due to cable and its dysfunctioning stuff. So fire kind of broke out from that particular cable, which escaped from the human eyes or the officials that were responsible for that. I don't know if that particular area was it was a populous area or not, but still when 80 people have died, it must have been a kind of populated area. And the cable and its fault was kind of not visible to the officials and authority, those who are actually responsible for that, because Moon rules people, and again Moon is debilitated here. So and the fact that all the planets are placed in between the in the nodal axis and between the nodal axis kind of acted as a major motivating force behind concealing it from the man's eyes. So moon is human. So since moon is kind of debilitated and not in a good dignity, I kind of suspect that it was never visible to those authorities who were responsible for the cable, and things kind of broke out from then on. Yeah.
Interesting.
So if you have something more to add to this, or if you have any other, and see, Mercury is technology, and cable kind of deals with technology, and Mercury is placed in the nodal axis and in the eclipse point. And in the national chart as well, Mercury, the planet that rules technology and stuff, is again placed in the nodal axis and the nodal point. And Moon is again placed in the nodal axis in the natal chart itself. So this is a perfect indicator of how things kind of fall away from the eyes of the officials or authorities that are actually responsible to this particular event. So, yeah.
I can see the role of Mars, which is playing out perfectly.
Yeah, Mars is probably the most important factor here, but considering that Greek kingdoms were once a mighty kingdoms, I just hope that Greece kind of rises up to their actual potential.
Yeah.
So if you have, yeah.
And I think because of Mars, I think that thing can also come, you know, that sudden thing which has happened. It's not.
Yeah, like, out of nowhere, yes.
Yeah, yeah. And I have seen, especially if it is Mars with Rahu, then like Mars Ketu was conjunct recently for 6 months, that
yeah
big transit.
Yeah, it was a horrendous and a terrible transit that we were all waiting for, waiting for Mars to move away from the nodal axis, and Mars in Aquarius.
Now Mars has moved away, but another planet is going to join Ketu very soon.
Yeah, and but I kind of have a lot of positive things to say. There are a lot of negative things. I don't want to talk about negative things at this point of time. But I think Saturn in Sagittarius along with Ketu is also a purification and a filtering effect, where we all will realize that we don't have to stick to materialistic version of life, and we might actually tend to we might have to look at the spiritual and philosophical version or sides of our own lives. And it is, I think it will also be applicable in mundane world as well. So there might be, and Jupiter will also be joining this conjunction, and there will be a lot of spiritual, religious, cultural, societal, and philosophical changes and transformations that will happen. And that is possibly the thing that we may talk when it comes to great conjunction, which is the conjunction between the Saturn and Jupiter. But still, I think Ketu Saturn is an interesting combination, even though it has a lot of negative stuff to say. I'm sure there is a lot of positive things to take out from it.
Yeah, what I feel is regarding that Saturn and Ketu conjunction, what I think people will realize is, like with Mars Ketu, people have realized, and I think, and I have also realized that we sometimes aggression may not work.
Yeah. Do you just want me to stop the screen share, because people might be
sure?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So since
what
we
just realized with the Mars Ketu conjunction is, depending on which houses Mars rules in our chart, depending on that, I have realized that sometimes we think that if we aggressively pursue something, we will get through it. We feel like that sometimes, and that's perfectly fine. That's what Mars is all about.
Yes,
Mars is that aggression. Mars says, "I will cut through anything. It's the sword. It's fire." Sun says, "I will stay where I am." Mars says, "No, I will go ahead."
Yeah, that's a funny.
Yeah.
No. Please go on.
Yeah, with Mars, when it came with Ketu, I realized that I realized two things. Depending on the houses which Mars rules, that first thing, aggression may not work always. And second thing is, we need not be aggressive sometimes. We may behave like a normal human being. Aggression is required. It's perfectly fine. But I got this lesson that some places, sometimes when karma has to come, you cannot cut through it using aggression. Because whenever Ketu gets conjunct with a planet, you will try to fulfill those desires or that karakatvas which the planet represents, but you will realize it was not needed. Like if Venus Ketu comes together in conjunction, then I always see people telling me that, oh, I thought that I will intensely move to this relationship with this partner, but then later on it didn't work out. So then people realize that, why did I at all move into a relationship with this person? Was it needed? Was it good enough? No. Or maybe yes, depending on the dasa. That, and we need not hurry up to, you know, move into that relationship if Venus is there. So with Saturn, that will happen. People will think that, oh, my work is enough. As is enough, work is worship sometimes. So those people will really be tested now. And then people will realize, in my humble opinion, that sometimes it's great to be hardworking. There's no problem with that. But sometimes it's not guaranteed that if you are hardworking, you will still get results. And those who already know this, I think for them, this is going to be a fantastic transit. And for those people who think that nowadays there's this this concept these days, yes, you can achieve whatever you want. You can do it. Just you need hard work. They say that earlier they used to say smart work is important. 20 years back they said, okay, hard work, hard work, hard work. Now around 5-10 years they started saying back, no, hard work is not enough. You must do smart work also. Okay. So nowadays people are like, oh, you need to work hard, smarter. You have to do smart work, but that also you have to do with a lot of intensity and passion. So people will realize, I think, that sometimes even if you work smart or you work hard, you may not get the results. And the more that happens, and now what will happen is from April, I guess, Saturn will be retrograde, right? So both will be moving back into Sagittarius. Thankfully, it will not enter Mula again. It will be oscillating. I can't hear you. Your audio is paused, I think. I can't still hear you. I can't hear you. Yeah, so we were discussing about the Saturn Ketu thing. So that was what I was saying, that I think that during this time of entire 2019, because Saturn will move to Capricorn in January, February of 2020, I guess, and Ketu will be in Saturn. And especially, I think the most dynamic part will be the time when Saturn and Ketu are both going retrograde from April to September. I mean, Ketu is always retrograde. That's his kind of direct motion. But so it's like saying ki Saturn and Ketu are coming together and then both are going.
Yeah.
That's going to be very interesting.
What is yes. I think it is kind of, we have this placement in the natural ninth house, which is the house of dharma and righteousness, which also deals with religions, philosophy, guru or mentor. So we might have some kind of transformation or real greater understanding in terms of those things that are signified by the ninth house. And as it is, ninth house is the 10th house of profession, and there might be some form of hurdles or like a dissatisfaction in terms of what we are doing as our profession, but I'm sure things will be okay with the position of other planets as well, because I think Jupiter is in Scorpio. The initial phase of Saturn and Ketu will give us a lot of understanding about philosophy and spirituality, and so many people who believed in God before that might turn into atheists, and so many atheists might turn into believers of God or theists, and this is a very common thing that may happen, and we might have to cut off some of the philosophical or religious ideas that we had before, and we might have some more new understandings and growth in terms of our spiritual or philosophical sense, and we might be inclined to actually communicate it to someone or a public forum, because we have Gemini, the natural house of communication, with Rahu in it, which will kind of provoke, just go and say to someone. So I'm sure the position of other planets will kind of influence what Saturn and Ketu have to actually signify. And coming back to what we were talking, I think the planet that is receiving is very important, and the planet in the nakshatra really speaks so much, or volumes. And I read somewhere that Vashishta in the Ramayana, Vashishta went to King Dasharatha and he said that your natal nakshatra is being afflicted by Mars and Rahu, where Sun is currently placed now, which is why he said that a ruling king is in danger, which is why Vashishta advised to kind of step down for that particular period of time, and then later on, he might just go ahead and appoint Lord Rama as a king of Ayodhya, because that is not the actual natal nakshatra of Rama. So the natal nakshatra of King Dasharatha was kind of afflicted, the nakshatra in which Sun was placed. So the transit Sun was conjoining with Mars and Rahu in transit, which is why Vashishta came and said that it is not good for a ruling king, and it might possibly be an eclipse, because Sun is making a conjunction with Rahu, and we are not sure about the time periods, so we never know for sure that if it was an eclipse, but we are sure that there is nodal axis I'm not sure which sign it is, but it is when Sun is in nodal axis, we with Rahu we have Ketu on the other side, so it is kind of nodal axis, and it is also important to understand that we need to take the nakshatra on which the eclipse falls into consideration, and I'm sure we'll be exploring those things when we are talking about the individual charts that are related to eclipses. So,
this is going to be a very interesting conjunction, Saturn and Ketu, and the best part is it's happening in Sagittarius.
Yeah,
Jupiter is also in Scorpio, so I think 2019 as a year will be a very important, crucial year for spiritual awakening. And if you get time sometimes, just check the transit chart of Christmas next year, not this year, 2019.
Okay, I think I'll check it right away.
Except Mars, Venus and Rahu, all planets are in Sagittarius.
Oh my.
6 planets. I don't know who will be born that day.
You mean 2019, right?
Christmas 2019.
Oh, yes.
All planets except Mars, Venus and Rahu, all are in Sagittarius.
it's a crazy conjunction.
Who will be born that day? I don't know.
Yeah. And
the best part is it's in Sagittarius. So let's see if something good comes out. You know, Jupiter, Ketu and Saturn in Sag. I mean, I'm loving this placement. for those ascendants who have Sagittarius in their Dustana, what will happen to them? And especially Sag Lagna, their life is like, too much is happening in our life. Anyways.
Sagittarius is my 8th house, so I'm kind of I'm kind of nervous, as you said that.
They will have a transformation, I think.
I don't know.
Thank you very much for coming. It was a great session. We had a lot of fun between the recordings and before, and I hope we will continue having this fun later also.
Sure.
So thank you very much for coming and explaining, and whoever wants to subscribe, which definitely you would want now, I think, after seeing him and hearing from him, then please go to his channel. You will find the link in the description down. And if you also want a consultation from him, then that also you can do. Okay. So thank you very much, sir. And we will see each other next time very soon.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.